Hello everyone, my name is Claudius Kazan. In this video, we continue talking about the major scales with flats, those on the left side of the circle of fifths. I also perform for you the number 23 from Robert Starr's rhythmic training book and solfege number 18. Please stay tuned. Welcome back. Let's continue talking about the major scales. Today we're going to touch on those scales with flats. Remember last time we talked about the major scales and how we got from one scale to the other by that wonderful interval of the perfect fifth. So we took the tonic of the new scale, we went up a perfect fifth, and we arrived at the new scale. We also noticed that that scale did not have a leading tone. We created the leading tone. We took that accidental and we put it into the key signature. All right, and this is how we built sharps. Today we're going to go the other way. Okay, instead of going up by fifth, we're going to go down by fifth. And we're going to start again at C major, just theoretically right now before we put the circle of fifth on screen again. So, if our tonic is C and we go down by perfect fifth, we're going to arrive at pitch F, right? C, B, A, G, F. And C to F is a perfect fifth, and we can start our scale now on pitch F. Remember one thing, we need to keep that formula going, the whole half, whole half, in order to have a regular major scale. Now, if I go to the piano and I start a major scale on pitch F, let's see what kind of modifications we need to make in order to arrive at that whole half, all right? So follow me at the piano, and I'm going to start my scale on pitch F, okay? Okay, this is the first thing here. If I go to B natural, right, I'm going to have another whole step, but I need to have a whole half. So I'm going to lower my fourth degree, my B to a B flat. Okay, and then continue normally. Oh, great. So I only need to make one little modification in here to bring the fourth degree from B to B flat, right? And I have my whole half. So this is my F major scale. Okay, great. So let's keep that in mind. Now, let's continue doing this. Let's see if we can have a pattern going here. So from pitch F, this is our new key with one flat, in the key signature. That is the B flat, right? We take that flat and we put it in the key signature because we're going to need it permanently if we need to stay in that key of F. So let's start now at F and let's go down another perfect fifth. F, E, D, C, B flat. Now why B flat? Because F to B natural, it's a diminished fifth. We need a perfect fifth. So I need to lower my B by another half step in order to have a perfect fifth, right? So F to B flat now, it's going to be a perfect fifth. So my new scale, my new major scale is going to start on pitch B flat. That's why from now on, all the scales are going to start on pitches with flats, all right? Because of this problem with the F to B being a diminished fifth. So B flat major, okay, we start on B flat and let's keep the same whole half going. So let's go back to the piano now and we start on pitch B flat now. Okay, here's the fourth degree again. I can't have it as an E natural because I need the whole half, right? So whole half. And then continue normally and end with a B flat, of course. All right, so here we go. B flat, E flat, same thing on the way back. Okay? So B flat major, right? B flat major will have two flats in the key signature. B flat, of course, coming from F, and the new one, E flat, which we just discovered right now by lowering the fourth degree, right? So you can see it right here on the tablet, B flat major with two flats in the key signature, okay? And the fourth degree always gets lowered on every new scale, and that flat gets transferred into the key signature, okay? So B flat major has two flats. Okay, let's go back to the circle of fifth right now. And let's look again at what we have in here. And we arrive here at C major. C major is where we started originally, no sharps, no flats. And we went to F, right? By the way of a perfect fifth down, remember? Okay, and that created F major with one flat in the key signature. Remember the first flat, it's always that fourth degree that gets lowered this time. So it's not the leading tone anymore. That's for the keys with sharps. For the keys with flats, it's the fourth degree that needs to get lowered every time we go down by perfect fifth, okay? And that flat needs to go into the key signature. So remember, for the keys with flats, it's the fourth degree that you need to lower, okay? So F major has one flat in the key signature, and that is B flat, okay? Next, we go to B flat major, right? B flat major has two flats in the key signature. B flat, of course, that comes from F, the first one with flats. New flat, E flat, right? And they both get transferred into the key signature. Okay, let's keep going for another one. Another perfect fifth down from B flat, okay? That takes you to E flat. Let's do it a little quicker right now. Trust me on this. B flat to E flat is a perfect fifth going down. And E flat has three flats in the key signature, okay? Let's go back to the piano and see that if I start on pitch E flat, fourth degree needs to get lowered, right? So instead of A natural, I need to use A flat. So B flat, of course, stays, and E flat, of course, stays too, right? So right now, the new flat, it's A flat. E-flat and B-flat come from prior keys, previous keys, and this is E-flat major. Okay, three flats in the key signature. Good, let's go on. Another perfect fifth down from E-flat. That takes us to A-flat, right? Trust me on this, A-flat major has four flats in the key signature. Okay, and let's theoretically do it now without the piano first. What would be the new flat that needs to go into the key signature in the key of A flat? Okay, well, we have B flat, E flat, and A flat from prior keys. What's the new one? What's the fourth degree in A flat? A, B, C, D. So D flat is our new flat that gets transferred into the key signature. So key signature for A flat major, B flat, E flat, A flat, and D flat. Okay, let's keep going. Another one. Okay, that takes us to from A flat, another perfect fifth down, takes us to D flat major. D flat major has five flats in the key signature, right? B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat from prior keys. The new one is fourth degree in D, D, E, F, G. So G flat would be our new flat. Okay? Great. You can see all these on the tablet as I keep talking about this. Great. Let's do one more. Six flats. Perfect fifth down from D flat is G flat. So G flat major has six flats in the key signature. Okay? And the new flat is, let's see, G, A, B, C, C flat. C flat, if I go to the piano, is enharmonic with B, right? Again, but I can't use B because I'd need to use all seven pitches in the scale, right? And my new flat in there is C flat. So G flat major, if I go to the piano, starts on G flat. I have to play C flat, right? and all the other flats. Okay, the only one that's not flat right now, it's pitch F, okay? But as we go down another perfect fifth to find out what the key with seven flats is, you'll see that all pitches right now will have flats. So C flat major, okay? Another perfect fifth down from G flat, it's C flat major will have all pitches flat. And the last flat that goes into the key signature finally is F flat, okay? Because that's the fourth degree and the key of C flat, okay? That's great. So now you know about all keys with flats, okay? And those with sharps from last time, okay? Next time we're gonna talk, we're gonna start talking about the minor scales, okay? But right now, we know all about this. Let me show you one little thing in here that I think it's kind of important. And this is the order of sharps and flats. This is a little shortcut that you can learn what sharps are used where and what flats are used there. Okay, the order of sharps is this: F, C, G, D, A, okay, E, and B. Okay? The order of flats, it's exactly the opposite of the order of sharps. Okay, so you start with B and then E, A, D, G, C, F. So if you know the order of sharps, you should also know the order of flats by going exactly backwards. Okay, when I was growing up as a kid, I remember my mom, you know, who knows a little music, used to recite this little thing for us because we knew solfege. And everybody learned solfège, everybody who's, you know, seriously interested in music learned solfège. And we used to say this, the order of sharps in solfège is fa, do, sol, re, la, mi, si, right? That's the order of sharps. And the order of flats, it's exactly the opposite. Si, mi, la, re, sol, do, fa. Okay, so we learned it so well, even to this day, I can go fa, do, sol, re, la, mi, si, and si, mi, la, re, sol, do, fa. Right? It's like a little poem that I learned. So it helps a lot if you know a little solfège, because you can associate these pitches with solfège names, which are so much easier to pronounce and to remember than the letter system. But, you know, solfège is still used a lot in Europe and so on, and all the music conservatories in this country as well. So please learn solfège. It's so important and so much easier. Now, let's talk about dominant and subdominant keys. I don't want you guys to be confused, okay? If you are going clockwise on the circle of fifth, let's put up the circle of fifth again, because that's so important, okay? Right here, you have the circle of fifth with all the major keys with flats highlighted, okay? If you are going clockwise, anywhere from any point in the circle of fifth, if you're going clockwise, you're moving to the dominant key, okay? If you go counterclockwise, you're moving to the subdominant key. I want you to really remember this. For example, let's take F major, for example, one flat in the key signature. So if you're going clockwise, where do you go if you go clockwise from F? You go to C, all right? You're taking away the flat, okay? That means you're moving to the dominant key. If you're going the other way, if you're going to B flat, if you're adding flats now, okay, you're moving to the subdominant key, all right? It was the opposite when you were in the keys with sharps. If you went clockwise, okay, you still went to the dominant key, but you added sharps, okay? If you went clockwise from a key with flats, you take away flats, okay? So I want you to not be confused about this, okay? Have the circle of fifth in mind all the time. Great, let's do a couple of exercises with this. First exercise, we are in the key of F, right? Please change a key signature to the dominant key and write in the tonic, the median, the subdominant, and the leading tone. So quite a few things in here. So we're in the key of F. We have one flat in the key signature, right? That's that fourth degree, F, G, A, B, B flat, it's in the key signature, right? So we need to move now to the dominant key. What's the dominant key in F? Well, let's go up by fifth. You hear dominant, you go up by fifth. F, G, A, B, C. Oh, C major. Oh, okay, so if I'm in F, I go up by fifth, I get to C major. Remember, C major has no sharps or flats in the C key signature. So my new key signature will be an empty key signature, right? Because I'm in the C major. And I need to write in the tonic. Well, of course, tonic is C. The mediant, what's the mediant? The third degree, see the E. So we need to have an E as well. The subdominant. That's the next pitch up, which is F, right? And the leading tone. What's the leading tone in C? That's B, right? Because B to C is a half step. So when I flip to the new tablet page, I should see the key signature change to C major, right? With pitches C, E, F, and B written in. So let's see. There we go. We take away the B flat, right? To create C major. The key signature of C major, and the tonic, the mediant, submediant, and the leading tone is in there. I'm sorry, I think I asked for the mediant, but I put in the submediant. We'll correct that, making sure that everything is fine. So we need in here the tonic, the mediant, the subdominant, the submediant, I'm sorry. No, actually it's good. It's mediant, submediant, and the leading tone. C, E, A, and B. This is just to give you a little more exercise with these, you know, scale degrees, the tonics, the supertonic, the mediant, the subdominant, the dominant, the submediant, the leading tone, and so on. Good. Let's do another one. We are in the key of B flat, two flats in the key signature. Please change the key signature to the dominant key and write in the tonic, subdominant, and the leading tone. Okay, so we need to go to the dominant again. So if we're in B flat, we need to go up by perfect fifth to get to the dominant key. That never changes, right? So B flat, C, D, E, F. All right, so B flat to F is a perfect fifth. Yes, it is. Okay, and we need to write in the tonic, which is F. We need to write in the subdominant, which is E flat, F, B flat, right? And the leading tone. What's the leading tone in F? It's E, right? Because it's already a half step away. Okay, so when I flip the page, I should be seeing one flat in the key signature. That's the key of F with pitch F, B flat, and E written down. There you go. F major with one flat in the key signature, right? We took away the E flat. That's why you see the natural sign on the E there, right? And we stayed again the flats, which is B flat. And the tonic is F, the subdominant is B flat, and the leading tone is E. Let's do one more and we're done, okay? Okay, now a little more difficult. We're in the key of D flat. D flat major has five flats in the key signature, right? And we need to change the key signature to the subdominant key and write in the tonic, the mediant, and the submediant notes. How do we get to the subdominant key here? Well, the concept is exactly the same. If you go down by fifth, by perfect fifth, you arrived at your subdominant, okay? If you go up by fifth, you go to your dominant. Down by perfect fifth, it's subdominant, okay? So what's the key of the subdominant from D flat? Well, you go down a perfect fifth from D, okay? D, C, B, A, G. But remember, it has to be G flat because D flat to G flat, it's a perfect fifth. So G flat major is your subdominant key. And what do you do when you go to a subdominant? You add flats, okay? You add flats when you go counterclockwise through the circle of fifth. So my new key will have six flats, okay? What's the new flat if I have to add another flat to what I already have in there. That's that C flat, remember? So my key signature will have B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat, and C flat, all right? So what do I need in here to write? I need to write in the tonic. Okay, tonic is G flat. The median would be B flat. The submedian would be E flat, all right? So I have three notes, G flat, B flat, and E flat. Let's see if that's correct. There we go, G flat, B flat, E flat, with those six flats that I named before. Okay, I hope you guys understand this. This is really, really important, okay? You have a clear picture now of all the keys with flats and sharps, the major keys with flats and sharps. Sharps are on the right side of the circle of fifth. The flats are on the left side of circle of fifth. With C major up in the middle, you add sharps, right, as you go clockwise from the 12 o'clock position, and you add flats as you go counterclockwise from the 12 o'clock position, okay? And I want you to take a look at the circle of fifth one more time, right here where we have all of them highlighted, okay? Look at the three sets of keys on the bottom of the circle of fifth. What do I mean by that? Look at the D flat and C sharp, okay? Those are the only three positions on the bottom there where you can actually see two keys together, okay? The other ones are just one. Okay, but in here on the bottom, you have three sets of keys that we call the enharmonic keys. They sound alike, but they spell very differently. D flat major and C sharp major. Okay, they sound exactly the same, but they spell very differently. One of them has five flats. The other one has seven sharps. Okay, if you were to write a piece of music that you wanted to sound in a certain, in this particular key, what would you choose, D flat major or C sharp major? I personally would choose D flat because it has fewer accidentals to keep track of, okay? And that's exactly. Now, it's a toss when you get to the one on the very bottom, G flat major versus F sharp major. One of them has six flats, the other one has six sharps. Which way do you want to go? Well, it all depends on what instrument you're writing for, okay? Pianists usually like more the keys with flats. And because I'm a pianist as well, I can attest to that. That yes, if you throw something at me that has more flats, the hand is positioned and so on, it's easier to read in the keys with flats than the keys with sharps. But on the violin, for example, it's much easier to write in the keys with sharps, okay? Because you're moving away a little bit from the first position on the violin, and it makes it easier. If not, you'll always be performing in what we call a half position on the violin, and that's quite uncomfortable, okay? It's possible, of course, and good violinists should be able to do it anyway, but it's so much easier to play in keys with sharps, where you move your fingers a little higher than the first position rather than you squeeze them back there. So just a little insight on the technique of the piano versus the technique on the violin, all right? So good. So remember all these things about the circle of fifth. Next week we'll start talking about the minor keys, okay? Those are represented in here in the lowercase letters on the inner circle, okay? And I'm dedicating two videos for the minor keys, okay? Because minor keys have three forms each, and we need to understand very, very clearly what's going on with the minor keys. But next week, we're going to talk about how we find the minor keys, you know, comparatively to the major keys. We're going to talk about the minor key model, right? Remember, two videos ago, I talked about the major scale model. Next week, we're going to talk about the minor scale model and what it entails and so on. All right, let's talk about solfege number 18. Okay, there's a few challenges in here. Number one is that it's written in D major, two sharps in the key signature. Okay, and you have to remember to sing fa sharp and do sharp unless otherwise stated. And there's a few places in here where it's stated otherwise, okay? So you have to remember that If you don't see an accidental next to do and fa, you have to sing them sharp. Okay? Please sing your pitches at home. Go through it very slowly. La, fa, mi, re, fa. Remember, we sing fa natural, but we don't say the natural sign. Okay? Same thing for the sol sharp later on. We just say sol, no sharp. Okay, but we sing the right pitch, the correct pitch in there. Okay. The rhythm is not that difficult, except for the fact that a few times you have a string of syncopations. One of them actually goes across the bar line from line 2 to line 3. On my printed sheet here, on the tablet, it's going to be a little bit different. All right, but other than that, just pitches. Pitches are very, very difficult to sound properly. Because of that, I am lowering the tempo now to 80 instead of 90. Okay, it gives you a little bit of time to sound the pitches. So let's see if that's going to help. I'm going to put the metronome again at 80 this time. Okay, and this is my beginning pitch. 2. La, fa, mi, re, fa, mi, la, sol, do, la, fa, re, si, mi, sol, fa, la, mi, do, la, fa, fa, mi, re, fa, si, do, mi, si, sol, mi, si, re, fa, do, si, sol, fa, mi, re, mi, la, do, si, re, si, sol, mi, do, re, fa, mi, do, mi, re, fa, re, do, si, mi, fa, re, do, si, sol, la, do, si, do, re, fa, re, do, si, la, fa, re, mi, sol, so, si, fa, re, si, do, si, la, sol, si, do, re, sol, fa, re, mi, la, la, si, do, fa, mi, sol, la, do, fa, re. All right, you can see why this one's quite difficult. It moves quickly through all those eighth notes, and the leaps are really what gets you in there. The leaps of six, of sevenths, and so on. Okay, so I hope you guys are studying these. Again, they're not easy, and you almost have to memorize them to make sense of what's going on here. But you don't have to, okay? You don't have to memorize them, but it definitely helps when you're dealing with sounding pitches and so on. Okay, great. Next time, for next time, I'm assigning you two more solfeges, okay? Number 19 and 20, and I will perform the number 20, always the second one in the set. All right, let's move on now to Robert Starr's number 23. Again, we're studying eighth notes in here, all right? So I will perform you the last four lines from number 23, and I will put the metronome back at 90 now. This is not so difficult, so I think I can afford 90 on this one, okay? Now, let's quickly look at this. It's written in 5-4, and because of that, you have to conduct on the formula of either 2 and 3 or 3 and 2. And he splits the bar line with that dotted bar line to help you with your conducting. Okay, for example, on line number 5 in here, right, I'm performing the last four lines. This one has 8 lines in here. So on the line number 5, you can see that you have to start conducting on the formula of 2 and 3, all right? And then the next bar, it's 3 and 2, and then 3 and 2 again. So, you know, there's no rhyme or reason which will come, so you have to really look in there. You have to be very focused and to look ahead a little bit and see, okay, is this a measure of 3 or a measure of 2, all right? Very good. So, metronome is at 90. And let's see how this goes. So, starting on line number 5 right now, the last four lines, number 23, Robert Starr. da 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 da. Okay, that's not too difficult, right? As you keep looking ahead, it should be quite clear on what formula you need to conduct, and it's so much easier. Okay, for next time, we'll just deal with number 24 for next time. Okay, this is in 6-4. Okay, and you can look in there up where he shows you how he wants you to conduct, either on the formula of 6, which means that there's no dotted bar line in there to help you out, or on the formula of 2, 2, and 2, he says, right, for the 6, with a dotted bar line in between those sets of 2. Okay, since this is a little new for you, I just want you to concentrate on the number 24 for next time. Okay, and then we have number 25 and 26, and we'll learn about triplets finally. All right, splitting the beat actually in 3 equal parts. That means triplets. Okay, so for next time, only the number 24, and I will perform the last 4 lines from the number 24 as well next time. Great. So in my next video, guys, we're going to start talking about minor scales. Okay, be here. Very important topic. We'll look to see how major scales and minor scales relate to each other. We're going to talk about the minor scale formula. Okay, and the solfege number 20 and Robert Starr number 24. I want you guys to stay healthy and safe until next time when we start talking about the minor scales. Be good.